Mirror test 3. Color, violet. Subject is D84930, male, 21 years of age, average physique. Subject's background shows instance of second-degree murder of a police officer during a drug bust. Normally, this crime, while severe, would not qualify a person for a sentence that would end up with us. But the murder of the officer was especially brutal, and excessive violence was used. This subject was uncooperative, and had to be reminded that his cooperation would only benefit him. Subject entered the provided mirror while holding SCP-093, which emitted a violet color. Outside technicians observed that the mirror retained a true reflection until subject had completely passed into it, at which time, the view changed to a cityscape, urban, lightly tinged in purple, similar to the first test. Video feed follows in attached media. Camera flickers to life and pans around the area. Subject is in what appears to be a modern downtown district, similar to a city like New York. The streets are mostly bare, except for a few cars of unknown make or model. These cars look highly advanced and streamlined. Subject attempts to look into the car windows without being instructed to, but backs away, remarking there is a rank-ass stank coming from the areas around most of them. Subject is persuaded to move closer to one car and does so with coughing, wiping off a window which is covered in dirt. The inside of the car appears to be completely filled with a strange brown matter. There is nothing at all visible other than the brown matter. Two other cars produce the same results. However, a fourth vehicle seems more recent than the others, and the insides are immaculate. The doors to this vehicle also are unlocked, and Subject quickly gets inside, then shuts the doors. Subject is chastised for this behavior by Control, who reminds him his lifeline is nothing more than a cable, which is sturdy enough that closing the car door does not injure it, but they cannot recover a person in motion. Subject argues with Control over this issue and pans the camera across the dashboard, pointing out he couldn't drive away even if he tried. The dashboard is void of any recognizable controls. No ignition, no steering. It has several small blank screens that are theorized to be a GPS system. Subject remains in the car while Control discusses how to proceed, since the city landscape is far larger than the previous test destinations. Control debates this issue while Subject stares around the cityscape from the car. During one pan, a face is clearly seen staring into the car, eyes watching the subject. However, this was not noticed until post-test footage review. Subject made no comment regarding this entity at any point. Control shortly after informs Subject to remain where he is, and an escort team is dispatched through the mirror to join him. A team of four armed personnel is sent through the mirror, and proceeds to Subject's location. Subject is then instructed to remove his harness, which is recovered. This subject's video feed then ends, and is replaced by a wireless unit used by the escort team. The video quality on this unit is subject to more interference, but in order to mark the mirror exit, a receiver system is placed through the mirror. Subject leaves the car and now travels with the escort team. Given the myriad of possible options, they are instructed to simply move to the closest building and attempt to enter it. This building has etched glass doors bearing the name XEA Research Partners, Inc., and the doors are ajar. A magnetic lock system is present, but has lost power. Team enters the building in main lobby. This area resembles a stereotypical corporate lobby. There is a C-shaped receptionist desk with a chair pushed far from it, as if it was left in a hurry. A PC terminal is at the desk as well. Team approaches the desk, and the camera bearer is instructed to examine the PC. The unit does appear to have power, and Faithful OS appears on the screen, requesting a login and password. A keyboard is present, but is remarkably slim, with touch-sensitive keys rather than press-down keys. After one failed attempt, the lock screen replies that maximum attempts have been exceeded, and the PC turns off. No actual tower or power button can be located, so team moves forward. Behind the receptionist desk are two elevator doors, one to the left and one to the right, with similar touch sense keys. The elevator on the left is broken, the door open and the shaft empty. The elevator on the right appears functional and has power. Without a clear destination, the team is instructed to proceed to the highest floor to get a lay of the city. All floors appear to be accessible, with the highest being 114, in reality 112, as 13 and 113 are missing from the keypad. Journey up the elevator is uneventful during this time. The elevator does appear to take longer as it passes by 13 and then 113, suggesting that entire floor was built and nothing put on it. At 114, the doors open, and team enters a large lounge-type area. There are many couches with dust on them, a widescreen apparently LCD TV of approximately 60-plus inches in size dominates the wall in front of them, with no power. A series of windows are open, allowing in sunlight at the far end, to which the team proceeds and angles the camera outside. The view of the city is astonishing. This building is one of the tallest visible, but certainly not alone in its stature. The city below is gray and silent, no evidence of life at this altitude. Some buildings in the city have a strange brown growth that appears to have been splashed against them, as if a gelatinous mass was flung and then seeped down before hardening. Other buildings have floors where the glass has been shattered, and the same brown substance is seeping out the edges. One member of the team calls the camera bearer to the windows on the other side. From the other side of the building, the city edges can be seen. Attention is pointed toward an expressway that encircles the city, upon which crawls another of the large half-body humanoids, dragging itself with its elastic arms as witnessed in previous tests. It travels the highway, then moves out of sight. The team returns to the elevator and notes that a button has already been activated for floor 74. No one has approached the elevator, so the team agrees to travel to this floor. On the 74th floor, the doors open and reveal a waiting area to what appears to be a doctor's office. At the reception desk, there is a sign-in sheet with a series of names and dates. The dates on the sign-in sheet all carry the year 1953. A PC at the receptionist area is on and functioning at a user desktop. The background for the PC is a large set of praying hands, with the word Faithful OS under them. On the desktop are a series of folders with years on them, containing files that, when clicked using the center button of the mouse, open to a Word viewer. All files appear to be appointment information. On the desk is a notepad titled, From the Desk of Dr. Borziski, Blessed Purificationist. The door to the doctor's area is sketched with the same name and title, as well as a crucifix. Opening this door leads to a white, dust-free hallway that has two examination rooms and a key-coded door at the end. The examination rooms are unremarkable and typical of any doctor's office. All medicine cabinets are empty. A small amount of C4 is placed at the lock to the key-coded door at the request of control, and then blown, forcing the door open. The area it opens into is much larger than the reception area itself, and seems to contain a series of large containment capsules. There are a total of 6 of these capsules. 2 are broken, and a brownish-amber material coats the floor coming from them. 1 is empty. The last 3 have nude humans floating in them, with breathing masks. Attached to the front of these tubes are medical charts, showing vital signs and conditions. For symptoms, the charts explain in somewhat awkward English ailments that seem more like flaws of personality or character, or just incidents that have occurred with the patient. Control asks for a zoom of one of the patient pages on the chart. After focusing, it reads, Citizen Jennifer McZerka did suffer a lapse of the heart that did lead her to lay with her neighbor twice upon nights of her husband's departure from their home. Patient did submit herself into the Lord's and our hands for cleansing of mind and body. Prayer administered by High Father Uwalakin, and patient submitted to a 3-day period in the Lord's tears to cleanse her system, then released in good spirits. The topmost page reads, Citizen Alberius Farafin struck out at a High Father during a sermon, blaspheming that the Lord's tears did turn his daughter to be unright in mind and heart, thusly laying blame for her whorish activities at the feet of the High Father and his blessing. With no proof of these blasphemies, the forgiving judge and the punishing judge did agree that Alberius Farafin should bathe in the Lord's tears himself for a week to be cleansed of mind and soul, thus to prove his daughter's ways are fault of not the Father's hands, and to give him peace of self. Subject, who has been traveling quietly with the escort team, now begins to panic. The camera pans to focus on him, and he is surrounded by entities similar to those witnessed in the first two tests. Escort team reports in that subject is having a panic attack, but control requests them to stand still and wait. Subject screams at the entities, which are denied to exist by team commander, stating subject is alone in the corner. Control requests that one team member be dispatched to approach and recover the subject. The escort team member approaches the subject as ordered. On the video, the figures part to make a pathway for the approaching member, who lifts subject to his feet and brings him out of the corner. Figures on video are then seen closing ranks to close the path. Subject is lifted to his feet by an arm and escorted through the figures that close their ranks when the subject is moved. They remain steadfastly staring at the subject, no matter where he moves to. Control requests the team to return now. Team turns to leave. Before leaving, a team member mentions something noticed at the reception desk, a binder labeled "The Lord's Tears." Control requests binder be returned as well, and it is stowed into subject's field kit. The team returns to the elevator and returns to the ground floor. Upon leaving the building, subject points down the street towards direction of entry point. The camera pans to a section of raised expressway, across which one of the large torsos is crawling slowly. The entity turns its featureless head to look at the escort team, raises its head to the sky, and emits a bellowing sound. Team leader issues the order to move, heading for the spot marked by the wireless video receiver. The creature on the expressway extends an arm down that stretches to touch the ground before the camera moves to the port. All team members save one move through entry point. Subject moves through entry point and mirror returns to reflective surface. SCP-093 is dropped by subject, who panics and tries to fight his way out of the room. Subject is terminated by team leader after he draws the field kit pistol. Team leader requests portal be reopened, but it takes several minutes to find someone who can hold SCP-093 and generate a similar color. When a matching color is displayed and applied to the mirror, the video receiver is visible, and all individuals report a horrific smell. Team leader moves through the entryway with control person. The uniform and possessions of the escort team member who was left behind are present and recovered, but the member himself is nowhere to be seen and does not respond to shouts. Member assumed KIA and wireless receiver recovered. Control and escort return through entry point, and mirror returns to reflective surface. Later review of the recovered camera shows escort member grasping at the air where entry point should be, and then turning to look up at the oversized torso. A brown gel seems to drip off the creature as it moves, but disappears shortly after being dislodged, as if evaporating. Several shots are fired at the creature's face that land in the face of the creature, causing a spray of less viscous brown liquid to pour forth from the wounds. It screams obscenities as the face of the creature descends upon him, and the camera is pushed to the ground. Camera feed remains dark for approximately 65 seconds before light comes back, and the camera films the creature crawling back to the expressway and pulling itself onto it, then crawling in the direction it was originally headed. Believed to have been absorbed by the creature, and perhaps digested. This may have been an example of how these unknown entities feed, by direct contact with living material. Further study is recommended to be avoided on this issue. The next test is classified as the yellow test. Mirror test 4. Color, yellow. D-class subjects no longer authorized for testing. Testing focus has been shifted to data collection after analyzing the articles brought back from the previous three tests to better understand the fate of the world accessed by SCP-093 and determine if safeguards or practices are required for our own world. Analysis of the brown fluid on the clothing of the lost escort team member has been filed with other recovered articles. Dr. has volunteered for this test, as out of the possible candidates, he was able to cause SCP-093 to undergo a new color change. There is no evidence in said doctor's background of any illegal or criminal behavior, nor of any psychological problems. When presented to the mirror, the view changed to that of a cubicle office environment. For this test, Dr. opted to use the wireless video system and forego the pulley return system, stating he was confident he would be safe, as none of the torso creatures have been witnessed within a building where the mirror's destination showed. Video feed commences after the doctor has crossed the mirror. As with prior tests, SCP-093's current color, yellow, tinges all video material. Camera flickers to life, and pans across a series of plain white cubicle constructs. Approximately 30 are visible. At the far end from the point of entry is an office module built into the wall, with frosted glass and a glass door. Dr. approaches this door and investigates the etched writing on it. Senior Manager, Stanley Millimitz. The door is unlocked. Dr. enters the office and examines the desk. A coffee cup is on the desk, a dark brown stain covering half of the inside as the liquid evaporated. There is a donut on a plate, which the doctor picks up and lobs at a wall. On impact, it thumps like a rock and falls. A file cabinet in the corner of the room draws the doctor's attention, and he goes through each shelf one at a time, stopping in the second drawer and taking out a file, then going back to the first and taking out two others. Continuing to the third and fourth drawers, he withdraws four additional files and spreads them all out on the desk. The files are blue filing folders, and he points with his finger and camera at a symbol on each of praying hands, stating aloud for the camera that all other files are stored in yellow folders. The blue folders are placed in his field kit. Camera attention is turned to the PC on the desk that is logged in and functional. Dr. comments aloud, wondering where these devices are getting their power from, as he noticed no power outlets. This PC's desktop contains the logo of Faithful OS, and even has sounds, clicks of the mouse followed by soft hymn-like hums, an opening of icons followed by angelic bells. The PC fails to yield any useful information to Dr. who abandons it and leaves the office. Approaching the other end of the office floor, the doctor presses a button on the wall for the elevator and enters, finding he's on the 34th floor of a building having an unusual number scheme. The keypad layout goes from negative 115 to 115 and includes all floors. Before pressing a floor button, Dr. requests that the wireless video transponder be moved to the elevator and replaced with a construction cone to mark the entry point. A second transponder unit is placed outside the elevator, and control is instructed to recover the second unit and seal the test chamber should something happen to him. Then, when all is arranged, he presses the button for floor negative 115. The descent down the elevator is long, consuming 15 minutes. During this time, the camera experiences one malfunction where the image jerks and turns to snow, restoring to show 14 other figures in the elevator with the doctor as video pans around, all of whom move as he moves to allow him space. They remain for 35 seconds, then the camera flickers to snow and returns. The doctor is now alone in the elevator dancing, as is assumed by the ducks and sways of the video feed. Dr. pauses to comment on a rising stench coming from below. At this point, the elevator has reached floor negative 108. The doctor presses negative 110 to interrupt the descent down, and exits when that floor is reached. The elevator doors open to an enclosed observation deck with several PCs and chairs. All PCs appear to have power. The ceiling to this deck is also glass, and above it, another deck is visible. Dr. approaches the monitoring stations and checks one of the PC screens. On the screen is the Faithful OS logo and a video feed toggling between four different views. The first view is a room of tubes, similar to those found in Test Violet, which number in the thousands. The second view is a closer-up view of these tubes, as a camera glides in front of each to monitor the contents. All tubes the camera passes by are broken. The third view is facing the opposite direction, as a camera glides vertically, checking each observation station. A total of 10 can be counted, and the doctor is visible as the camera passes by his own station. Looking up, a hovering camera unit with no visible means of propulsion glides up past him. The fourth view shows the ground floor below the observation deck, where a single astonishingly large torso being is crawling in circles, bumping into walls and changing directions. From the camera feed, the creature's estimated size is 6 stories. Returning attention to the contents of the PC, Dr. moves the video log aside to see a simple text editor that was hidden behind it. A printout of this text was recovered and filed in the field kit. The printout directed the doctor to a safe on floor 54 and provided a combination. He leaves the observation deck and proceeds to 54 without a vent, arriving on a cubicled office floor. He proceeds to the desk mentioned in the document and finds a safe hidden beneath a desk undisturbed. The combination provided opens the safe and reveals a notebook filed in the field kit and a peculiar revolver, in addition to the 24 rounds of ammo found with it. Dr. proceeds back to the elevator without a vent and returns to 34. Given the sheer number of floors available to explore and the vital information obtained from the observation deck, the test is considered over and equipment is retrieved. Before returning through the entry point, Dr. investigates a terminal nearby that has power and finds it shows the exact same screen the one on negative 110 shows. It is theorized that the author of the note installed a network virus to propagate it through the building, so any PC on that network would be found and the information discovered. The doctor returns through the entry point, and the mirror returns to a reflective surface. All materials filed with other SCP-093 recovered materials. Analysis of the revolver and the ammunition for it postponed, for a reason that it would require deconstruction of one of the rounds, and they may be beneficial until testing of SCP-093 is resolved. Video ends. The next test is classified as the Red Test. SCP-093 Mirror Test 5. Color: red. SCP-093 distributed amongst staff until a new color could be generated by contact with it. One of the service technicians was able to cause SCP-093 to take on a fierce red hue and glow, much brighter than the object's normal color. He agreed to assist with a test of SCP-093. Per Dr. Reed's request, data expunged given to technician for use in this test. When applied to the mirror for the test, SCP-093 generates an unknown environment. No color tinge appears present on the display destination, which is comprised of red stonework. The technician enters the mirror, and video capture begins. Video flickers to life, and the technician, known hereafter as Subject, is viewing a large cylindrical pillar that is rotating on its own. Object is of unknown height and appears to be 1.8 meters, or 6 feet, in width. Holes are distributed throughout the object at seemingly random intervals. On occasion, a beam of white light is emitted from those holes. Turning of the camera finds that the beams are connected to a multitude of objects similar to SCP-093 that are part of the room's wall. The room turns out to also be cylindrical in shape, with countless copies of SCP-093. Subject turns back to entry point and finds it is a section of the wall that is missing its copy of SCP-093, presumably the one carried with Subject. Other sections of the wall on inspection are also found to be missing their copies, leading to speculation that this may be some sort of central array. Subject finds a ladder in the floor while examining the room and proceeds down it at Control's request. The ladder exits into a large, clean room full of computer equipment that appears antiquated compared to previously encountered equipment. Large computers running on reel-to-reels are clicking and spinning at various locations. A light bulb of unknown means turns on for 10 seconds, then turns off. A large CRT monitor is displaying single words in 8 colors at roughly 5-second intervals. While observed, the words clean, unclean, clean, clean, lost, unclean, flash on the screen. Proceeding through the room, it ends in a large glass window as another observation deck. This deck looks out over another series of tubes, as witnessed before, but far fewer, and filled with a blue liquid. What appears to be electrical current dances over many of the tubes at erratic intervals. At least 5 tubes at first glance are empty and broken. At the observation window, a keyboard is present on a pedestal, awaiting a selection to be made. The options available on the screen are Tube Status, which waits for a numerical input, Reports, Situation X549, Situation X550, Evacuation Log, Agent Report, and facility fire plan. Video expunged. All selections that generated text were transcribed by subject and verified by a control member who passed through the portal to recover them. This process took approximately 2 hours, and video feed was deleted to condense this report. Recorded documents are filed as data expunged. Video interrupted. Control lost contact with subject approximately 30 minutes after departure of control tech. Subject was asked to remain in area and observe the machinery and the containment room to make observations for debriefing. The SCP-093 mirror portal returned to a reflective surface prematurely, and all video contact with subject was lost. Control was unable to re-establish due to SCP-093 being across the mirror. A time lapse of 1 minute and 48 seconds was recorded before mirror portal re-established itself, and subject returned through portal. Subject appeared to be in good health and condition, despite the time loss, but spoke little. During immediate debriefing, subject underwent sudden convulsions, and medical staff was alerted. While attempting to subdue subject, he displayed enhanced strength and used data expunged to shoot one of the debriefing staff, killing them. Guards shot subject once with a sidearm in the heart and once in the chest, but subject did not fall. All staff evacuated room, and a second shot was fired by subject, which missed. A more heavily armed team entered debriefing room and used automatic weapons to dispatch subject. Reports confirm that subject did not bleed when shot, but instead leaked a green-brown substance that seemed to be a mix of solution observed in some containment tubes and the material recovered during Test 3. All further SCP-093 tests have been discontinued, while review of materials recovered is in effect. A secondary tape recording device was found to have activated in the field kit after loss of video feed, and its contents have been filed with other recovered materials. All recovered materials from SCP-093 testing are Level 4 classification. Release must be approved by no fewer than 2 Level 4 personnel. End of entry. If you missed the previous orientation, go watch SCP-093 Experiment Logs Part 1, The Blue and Green Tests, right now. And make sure to subscribe to SCP Orientation today.